Campers, it's me, Ari Lehman, the first Jason Voorhees. From Friday the 13th, I'm here with AJ, and he's got the juiciest slice ready for you. It's dripping with blood. Jason never dies.
What makes a horror film kill memorable, terrific, even in some way profound or poignant? Let's explore. Thanks for checking this out. If anything about it trips your fancy, please like, subscribe, and share.
Yes, yes.
Without further ado... After a fiery ball collides with the Earth, some sort of digestive living goop that came from inside it springs onto an unlucky vagabond who was too curious for his own good. The obviously upstanding young jock Paul throws his pal a few bucks to buy protection.
I'm gonna score with Vicky tonight. I want to invest a little protection. Come on.
Let's go, boys. It's closing time.
Alright. Make it quick.
But no good deed goes unpunished.
They're for my friend.
Oh.
There's this sort of naive girl that he's planning on,
With a friend like that, who needs enemies?
I insisted that he take precautions.
Why doesn't he pay for them?
I had to drag him down here as it is. I mean, the guy is totally irresponsible.
Paul goes to pick up his date, Meg.
What do you want?
Hi, I'm here to see Meg.
What for?
Despite her brother giving him the business.
Just to see her. Is she home?
Just a minute.
Her mom is more than welcoming.
I'm terribly sorry. You must be Paul. I'm Meg's mother.
Hi, nice to meet you, ma'am.
Well, come on in. Meg will be right down.
When taking out a young lady, if Dad's in the picture, it's always wise to meet him and try to show your intentions aren't entirely impure.
Daddy, I'd like you to meet my friend Paul.
But for Paul, that will prove impossible. The local motorcycle riding outsider in a leather jacket named Brian Flagg has an encounter with the unfortunate transient. When the panicking old man bolts, out of concern, Flagg follows.
Hey!
Unknowingly on a collision course, Paul and Meg happen down the very road the vagrant will soon cross.
I'm really sorry about my dad. I've never seen him like that before.
That's okay. It was just a misunderstanding.
Credit to Paul for keeping his cool in an awkward moment and not blowing his chance with Meg while recognizing the source of his trouble.
I've made better first impressions, though, that's for sure.
Well, no harm done, I guess.
No, wrong. Scott Jeske is gonna die.
Proving Paul and Meg are star-crossed lovers, I mean, did someone cast a disaster spell? Their date is further complicated.
Paul, watch out!
Flagg emerges and is oil to Paul's water.
What'd you do to him?
Yeah, I'm not the one who bounced him off my car.
Yeah, pal. Right! You ran him in the middle of the road!
Stop it! Let's get him to a doctor!
Hey, watch out. He's got some kind of corrosive shit on his hands.
The vagabond offers an explanation.
The sky. It fell from the sky.
That's taken very seriously.
What's he saying?
He's in shock. Let's just go.
Paul takes charge and gets all tough and uptight.
Get in the car. Before, there's going to be a lot of explaining to do and you're part of it. Now, are you going to get in the car or am I going to make you get in?
Flagg, who I'm guessing will get the better in a tussle sense, good guy athletes don't have anything to match anti-hero mojo, makes a joke out of it.
What's the matter, Taylor? You worried about a little insurance claim on Daddy's car, huh?
And is smart enough to cover his tuchus.
Maybe I will come along. Just to make sure you don't blame this whole thing on me.
Meg is tired of their antics.
Are you two finished?
Measuring your dicks? That's a good question since a man is currently being eaten alive.
Whenever you're ready.
Evidently, the jadedness of the medical industry was as prevalent then as today.
Does he have Blue Cross?
I don't know.
Medical insurance of any kind?
I don't believe this shit.
I know Flag is trying to help.
Take it easy, old dude. These guys gonna fix you right up.
But why not just wish the guy good luck for the audition of his life? The old fella gets taken to a room to wait for a doctor, and Flag sees his opportunity.
Hey, where are you going?
These people don't give a shit about explanations. If you need me, you know where to find me.
Paul and Meg stick around to fill out the paperwork.
I bet you've had better first dates, huh?
I don't mind.
And when he steps out to get sodas, he witnesses the sad fate of the vagabond. A little rattled, Paul makes a beeline for a phone.
Sheriff's Department.
Get me the sheriff, it's an emergency.
Having gained mass since devouring the old man, the blob proves predatory, stalking its next meal.
Sheriff, this is Paul Taylor.
Oh, what's wrong?
Paul relates the relevant points to the sheriff as his doom positions itself above his head.
And Brian Flagg was here earlier.
Flagg? Where is he now?
Then the blob attacks, or more appropriately, feeds.
Paul!
Set upon, Paul has no prayer once caught in the blob's sticky, viscous embrace. Meg's attempts to give him a hand. Results in Paul inadvertently giving her his. After seeing all that, I don't consider this. The response of a wilting violet, but a true-to-life reaction some have when presented with such a shocking and unbelievable sight. She was lucky to get out of there alive.
How about it, Earth? Can we take her home, though?
Yeah, you may as well, Tom. Make sure she gets a good sleep, huh?
Sometimes what elevates an exit to extraordinary, besides a truly grotesque presentation bound to stick, no pun intended, with even the most hardened horror fan, is when it acts as something of a line in the sand, a symbol by which the audience is enlightened to an uncomfortable fact. The movie doesn't play favorites. Film decorum was established when the moral code went into effect in Hollywood, and for the next several decades, several prototypical, somewhat stereotypical, black and white character types were established and used ad infinitum, one of which was the handsome young athlete who, in a monster movie, when the shit goes down or the shit hits the fan, will step up and be the hero, proving he deserved all those cheers earned on the playing field for more than exemplary athleticism. Paul's gory death dashed expectations by showing the guesswork of who was going to survive wouldn't be as easy as in a lot of flicks, and foreshadowed several notable exits, some of which I will likely cover in the future.
I'm excited.
A solid link to reality in a storyline relying on fantastical science fiction elements aids suspension of disbelief. And what could be a more solid link to reality than acknowledging that thing no one likes to think about? Namely, life plays no favorites. Anyone can die anytime for any number of dumb, pointless reasons. When there's no main character protection, no plot armor that indemnifies a character from getting got, that adds a great deal to the excitement, thrills, and suspense because anything can happen, and in this film does. Meg running away would have made more sense because it's a little perplexing and inexplicable that the blob didn't go ahead and take her too, like a snake moving on to the next egg in the nest. But I can believe after assimilating most of two people, it might need a few minutes to settle before moving on to the next conquest. With leading man Paul's exit, the film suggests that sparing her could only be a prelude to her getting it even worse later.
I don't have time for these shenanigans.
Another wrinkle to this exit is that it goes for the heights of body horror. In that department, it excels on multiple levels. The blob works as a perfect analogy for a fast-acting disease or other ailment, like a flesh-eating infection or cancer, quite literally disintegrating a body in real time. It also ably plays on the fear of being swallowed alive and digested. Paul is a healthy and capable young man, but he's powerless before the digestive prowess of the blob, which takes him with seeming ease, running through him faster than Taco Bell after a night of drinking.
Yep, that stands up to scrutiny.
The slimy, corrosive enzyme element reminds me of whatever the thing used to consume someone before replicating them. And how Brundlefly's eating habits allowed him to lay waste to human flesh and bone, melting it almost instantaneously. It's fascinating that three of the great remakes of the 1980s would all tackle body degeneration terror so astoundingly and terrifyingly well that each raised the bar a little higher. With the other two pushing the limits of practical effects, I see why the blob upped the ante and maybe emerged as the most intense and gruesome of the three.
I will allow you this.
One thing the film makes clear, the blob getting someone is grueling and agonizing, like falling in lava or a vat of acid. So everyone who dies dies horribly. With Paul and Flagg's dynamic, the film might be making a sly comment about the haves and have-nots, and how class assumptions reign going both ways. I would like to believe their obvious prejudice is personal, as in their mutual dislike stems from sensible reasons, and not born out of class biases. As a normie who fits one of the acceptable shapes that gets you into the good shape sorting cube of life, not the crummy box that fits the sort of odd shapes Flagg presumably represents, before knowing anything, Paul is quick to get threatening and play tattletale, real square moves. Meanwhile, asymmetrical quadrilateral Flagg assumes the popular jock will throw him under the bus no questions asked. As anyone who has watched this knows, Flagg is the protagonist. So early on, whose side does the film want you to be on? I think it plays it ambiguous enough that neither is particularly likable or unlikable, leaving the door open for either to emerge as the audience proxy. The misdirect was purposeful. The film seems to walk mostly in the footsteps of the original, suggesting Flagg was the one introduced to be fodder for the blob, until revealing the clean-cut good boy was being supplanted by the guy who looks like he walked off the set of The Outsiders.
Ooh, it's like being stabbed in the ears.
The film was accused of being more violent and cynical than its predecessor, but I would say it reflected a more nuanced and realistic view of the dichotomy of people. How not all jocks are great, and not all outsiders are bad. And when there's a common enemy, their differences don't matter anyway, since the blob has no prejudices at all when it comes to melting people.
Oh, Lord.
I've about reached the end of the rope, so I won't leave you dangling. Thanks for hearing out my ramblings. Please share any refutations, opinions, accusations, japes, or other ideas in the comments below. And please check out whatever I'm up to next time. Bye now!
Bye, creepy man! Keep it creepy!
He's a weird guy!
Timing's everything.
Come on, Scott, what's the holdup? I can't keep this girl waiting.
The boy doesn't need condoms. He needs a muzzle.